Hello, my name is Jim Schall, and I am an instructor for Federal Highway Administration training delivered under the National Highway Institute. The National Highway Institute, or NHI, is the training branch of the Federal Highway Administration. The videos you're about to watch are based on some of the training courses developed by the National Highway Institute, in particular, the Introduction to Highway Hydraulics course, NHI course 135065, and the Culvert Design course, NHI course 135056. I've been an instructor for National Highway Institute training courses for 25 years. I completed my undergraduate engineering degree at Purdue University and did my master's and PhD at Colorado State. The videos are based on demonstrations and experiments that we do primarily in these two training courses, built around a portable flume. The flume is 6 inches wide and approximately 5 feet long and recirculates water from a 30-gallon sump. The videos, there are six of them to watch. The recommended order in which to watch those videos: first, open channel flow concepts, then grate inlets, culvert hydraulic concepts, hydraulic effects of culvert liners, aquatic organism passage design concepts, and energy dissipators for culverts. Thank you for your interest in Federal Highway Administration training. I hope you find this video series helpful in completing highway drainage design projects. This video will demonstrate the hydraulic performance of a culvert traditionally designed to one designed more with the AOP, aquatic organism passage design criteria. We'll be looking at changes in the velocity through the barrel using a floating ball, and we'll also be looking at changes in the headwater elevation. Initially, I'll run the water through a culvert that is designed the way we traditionally have done it, which is to maximize the available ponding, the headwater depth at the upstream side, allowing us to downsize the barrel, minimizing the construction cost of that particular crossing. Then we'll look at a culvert designed with AOP considerations in mind. An AOP culvert is oversized. It's typically embedded into the stream channel to simulate what I have here, a natural invert, 20 to 40% embedded, or it could be a pipe arch type culvert with a natural invert or a arch culvert. The idea with that is that the natural material slows the velocities down. One of the fish passage barriers, AOP, aquatic organism passage barriers, is high velocity. Another one is shallow flow depths. And so additional roughness reduces velocity, increases flow depth. We'll be comparing the hydraulic performance of these two at a couple different flow conditions. The first flow condition is what I would call the design cue. As engineers, we still have to be sure that whatever culvert we design passes the required design discharge, typically of 25-year return period or maybe a 50-year return period flood. That's a pretty good size flood. And in aquatic organism passage design, we don't typically design for fish passage at those flood flow conditions. There's design standards that have been developed by the Federal Highway Administration that are presented in Hydraulic Engineering Circular number 26, based around a stream simulation design concept. And part of that is defining a range of discharge at which fish movement and aquatic organism movement will occur. If we think a minute what that really means, certainly at a flood flow at this 25 or 50 year design condition, we don't normally see fish moving around. It's like us going out during a storm. We quite often will wait till the storm passes and then go about our business, go to the grocery, do our shopping, whatever. Fish do the same thing. They're not going to be out moving around, foraging, looking for food at the time of a storm. They're probably going to be down in a pool waiting for this flood flow condition to pass. So AOP design, following a stream simulation concept, defines the bandwidth between which fish are thought to be moving, the Q high flow condition and the Q low flow. The QH, as I call it, the Q high flow condition, is the condition at which the fish might still be moving around, but anything above that gets into the flood flow conditions that they're not going to be spending too much time in the stream channel. They're going to be hanging out in a pool somewhere. In contrast, the Q low is such a low flow condition that, and it might be, say, during a drought, where the stream is particularly dry, the flow depths are really shallow, maybe the temperature of the water is really hot, and at that time, the fish as well aren't going to be moving around. They're going to be hanging out in a pool waiting for better times, right? Better conditions. So the QH and the QL define a bandwidth between which the fish movement, the aquatic organism passage movement, is expected to occur. So we'll look at a flood flow condition first, where we have an HW over D of 1.5 approximately, meaning we've ponded up stream of the barrel like we might have done in a traditional culvert design. On my 2-inch culvert, which in my 1-to-12 scale model is a 2-foot culvert in the prototype, and we'll compare that then to a more AOP friendly culvert design. In this case, it's a 4-inch barrel or a 4-foot pipe embedded 20% to 40%. So let's start with the traditional culvert design. We'll mark the headwater at this flood flow condition. We'll look at the velocity with the ball, and then I'll switch over to the AOP structure and we'll look at the same flow conditions. And then we'll lower the discharge down to something more in the realm of this QH to QL range. So marking the headwater with my stilling well. I'm trying to get to maybe 1.5 HW over D, headwater depth to diameter. And again, this is how we might have traditionally designed a culvert. We create some ponding upstream to minimize the size of the barrel we're going to need. But by so doing, we end up with a culvert that's really not very fish friendly, right? Because we have pretty high velocities. If I run this ball through, I'll do that a couple times so you can see it. It's moving quite fast. That's a fish passage barrier. Fish would have trouble swimming upstream against that current. And even if they could swim upstream against that current, they might get to the upstream side so exhausted that they don't survive, or they're subject to predation at that point. So let's, with a good headwater, let's go ahead and switch over to the AOP design. Which again would be a larger barrel that's embedded 20 to 40%. And part of the reason to show it at this flow is to demonstrate that we can still pass the design cue. And again, as engineers, that's one of our first responsibilities, is the safety of the traveling public and to make sure this culvert is, from an engineering point of view, safe. You can see that the ball, even at the design flow, is traveling at a slower rate down this barrel. This is still not a fish passage flow because, again, the fish aren't going to be swimming around at the flood flow condition. Notice we're passing this flow at a lower headwater, which also means these AOP designs, even with the increased roughness, we got a larger barrel. We're able to pass our design cue, our Q25 or our Q50, with less headwater, giving us more capability to surcharge, more ability to take a larger flood if that comes along, is one possible advantage of this AOP design approach. But let's go ahead and slow this down now to something more in that QH to QL range. And I do have to slow it down quite a bit because one way of calculating the QH is it's approximately 25% of the 2-year flow. Well, the two-year flow is already fairly small. You take 25% of that, you can see that we're really not defining a bandwidth with large flow conditions when we're talking about fish passage. So now let's look at the velocity of the ball under this condition. And as you can see, we hardly have enough velocity to even make it move. Let me increase the flow just a little bit. I may have gone below the QL. Okay, so there we go. And that's the idea. The rocks and the roughness increase the flow depth to allow fish swimming and also reduce the velocity down to a level at which they can easily traverse the culvert. When you have larger roughness elements like this, if that's part of your natural bed material, it also provides resting areas when the rocks get particularly large. So I'll go ahead and mark this headwater, and we'll compare this flow condition with, again, my more traditional culvert design and see how the velocity in the headwater compares at a flow in the range of the QH to QL. So the headwater doesn't change very much. The velocity is clearly faster than it was with the rocks. Remember, we had trouble even getting the ball to move in the AOP structure. And that's the benefit of an AOP design. Slowing the velocities down, increasing the flow depths. We're getting flow depths here because of our smooth boundary that might not be deep enough for a fish to even swim through the barrel. One of the early design concepts in AOP design was the thought of using baffles to create the roughness we need to increase the flow depth and slow the velocity down. Let me put the AOP structure back in. Using the baffles to illustrate what that would look like. So the idea of the baffles, particularly this alternating design, was to create a more sinuous path as well and to create some resting areas. And it may be that I've got too much flow. There we go. But you can see, and this is kind of what happens, in fact, problematically with even organic material and trash that's coming down the channel. That was one reason baffles were less than desirable, because baffles often cause a culvert to plug. So in the newer design concepts, the idea of using baffles is typically limited to a retrofit. If you're designing a new structure or a replacement culvert and providing an AOP design, the preferred option is to design the culvert with either an embedded structure or use a pipe arch that's embedded, or an arch culvert, allowing that natural invert to develop, oversizing the barrel. And one of the common complaints and concerns about this is, yes, this is a larger barrel and it will cost more money initially, but perhaps it's not as much in the long run as you might think when you start comparing the capital cost to the maintenance cost. Certainly a larger culvert like this is going to have less trouble with debris blockage at the upstream end, which is a common maintenance headache for our traditionally designed culverts. The natural invert will protect the channel, the culvert invert, from the channel material that's moving through the bed material, so that you may not perforate the invert quite as quickly. And in total, over the life of the culvert, you may actually have a lower life cycle cost, or at least comparable. So the idea of an AOP structure is to create a design that allows fish passage and aquatic organism passage to occur, with some of the common fish passage barriers being shallow depths that inhibit swimming, high velocities, perched outlets. That's a big problem that we have with traditional culvert designs, where we have a scour hole forming at the outlet of the barrel because of the high velocities coming out of that barrel, creating a situation where a fish has trouble getting up into the barrel and moving to the upstream side. All of this information and the design procedures are summarized in Federal Highway Administration Hydraulic Engineering Circular Number 26, Culvert Design for Aquatic Organism Passage. And if you need more information, that's a good resource to turn to. Thank you for your interest in Federal Highway Administration training. I hope you found this demonstration of the comparisons between a traditionally designed culvert and a culvert designed with AOP in mind useful.